And the feast of the Assumption of the Blessed Virgin Mary into heaven brings us to reflect, I think, on a number of connections that are clear enough in the mystery of faith and in the words of sacred scripture, clear enough by the nature of the feast itself, for its celebration takes us to the very threshold of eternity. And in the face of death, our own or even that of others, the meaning of life becomes clearer. Sometimes people live recognizing that there is no meaning as far as they can make it out, and so death is simply something they face stoically and nonetheless are able to accept with dignity. But people of faith believe that in that passage from this life to the next, many things will become clear that now we know only through a glass darkly, as St. Paul says. We will see everything whole, because we'll see things as God sees them, and all the connections will be evident. There's a connection in the reading from the book of Revelation between the Old Covenant and the New. The connection is the Ark of the Covenant, which, as you know, was an elaborate box that was described in the book of Deuteronomy, because Moses insisted this was how God wanted it to be done. It enclosed the tablets of the law that Moses himself had given to the people, perhaps a few other things that reminded the people when they saw that box of how God had liberated them from slavery in Egypt to a new land that was promised them. It was, in other words, a way in which God was omnipresent, was nonetheless localized, particularly made present to his chosen people. And the vision of St. John of Patmos talks first of the Ark of the Covenant and goes immediately to a woman whom we associate with the Blessed Virgin Mary, for the woman has a child in her womb, as Mary Paul carried the infant Jesus in her womb. And of course, it is Jesus who localizes God's presence in the New Covenant, who is the kingdom itself, who is the incarnate Son of God, eternal from all eternity, and now made part of our nature because born of the Virgin Mary. She is the Ark, therefore, of the New Covenant. And in seeing the way in which God's self-revelation in history, while very different from age to age, from one covenant to another, and very different in other ways since, nonetheless is consistent. There is a pattern in the way in which God saves his people. And that connection is made in the readings we have heard from the book of Revelation. What comes together is God's plan to be with his people, to accompany them in good times and in bad. And another connection is made between time and eternity. For in Mary's assumption into heaven, seen in the light of her son's resurrection from the dead, we see how something that is mortal, our own bodies, that decay, that face death and go through it, become immortal, become free of the last barrier of death itself. In Christ's resurrection from the tomb, with the body that was his, that came from the womb of the Virgin Mary, but now transformed, not subject to the laws of space and time, able to be in any form that he wants to be, whether in the bread and wine of the Eucharist or in the actions of the church's ministry or in any other way. Nonetheless, it is Christ, truly Christ, risen from the dead, now immortal, and Mary's assumption into heaven is seen in the light of that. Christ, her divine son, rises from the dead. She is assumed into heaven. But we see how bodies transformed by the Holy Spirit are themselves and yet totally changed. The Spirit is the Spirit of love. Love is stronger than death. And so it is love that connects time and eternity. Love that overcomes even the last barrier. Love that keeps us united with those who have gone before us in faith. there is a third connection. That is the connection between the happiness and the glory of the Blessed Virgin Mary and our Lord. She was one who, like us, is a disciple of her divine Son. She is one who listened to his word, the word incarnate, first of all, that dwelt in her womb, and then the word that was preached by him and then the apostles, in such a way that her life was a constant response, and a first response in the fiat that enabled God's salvific will to become present in her womb, is given us in the visit that she made to her cousin Elizabeth, and the Magnificat, the marvelous hymn of praise to God's ways. She enters into God's kingdom because she is, first of all, servant. Mother, certainly, virgin always, but servant. And in that, she is like us. We are part of that kingdom because we are God's good servants first, and everything else follows from that. And therefore, her happiness, her glory, show us our future. Our happiness, our glory, are caught up in Mary's Magnificat because they're caught up in her life and his destiny, which is ours. There is, as well, a particular connection that we celebrate today. Today we connect the beginning of one's consecrated life 50 years ago in the case of two of your sisters, and its present form now, in this place and time. And there is a connection which is that of faith. For consecrated life makes absolutely no sense without faith. If God does not exist, then this is an utterly stupid way to live. It is faith that tells us that a vow of chastity makes no sense in what, unless one believes in the bodily resurrection of the dead. It is faith that tells us that a vow of poverty makes no sense unless one trusts in the infinite and omnipotent providence of God. And it is faith that tells us a vow of obedience makes no sense unless one can discern God's action, God's intentions, God's kingdom at work even now, in this life, in the world. That is why the Church truly treasures religious life, consecrated life. Because it is consecrated life, more than anything else, that prevents secularization of the world. And that stops the Church from self-secularization in every age. We know what a church would look like without the monasteries, without the religious houses. Think of the England of Henry VIII's time. Henry VIII was smart enough to keep the parishes, or else people would be very upset. But he suppressed the monasteries because they were in the way of his total sovereignty, of his total taking over of the kingdom and transforming it into a royal dictatorship. Every time that someone wants to attack God's kingdom, they go first to the monasteries. They go first to consecrate. Consecrated life makes no sense if God does not exist. And therefore it is a treasure that must exist in its fullest glory from generation to generation until the Lord returns to the world. For contributing to its existence and its flourishing here in the Archdiocese of Chicago,